All right, namaskar and a very warm welcome to everyone attending today on our 42nd Know Your Species Zoo Talk. This talk is being organized by the Central Zoo Authority, New Delhi, as part of the ongoing Azadi Ka Amrit Mahotsav. The Mahotsav is a 75-week-long celebration to commemorate 75 years of India's independence, which falls on the 15th of August 2022. The Central Zoo Authority is taking the celebration forward through a massive outreach campaign entitled Conservation to Coexistence, The People Connect. Under the helm of this campaign, we are showcasing 75 conservation priority species and 75 zoos, highlighting one species and one zoo each week. We are currently in week 42 of this celebration with the common water monitor as the species in focus and the zoological garden Alipur as the zoo in focus. So joined in today to speak to us on the species is Dr. Varad Giri, who is the head scientist at the Reliance Foundation. Dr. Varad has done his doctorate from the North Orissa University and has been actively studying amphibians and reptiles for over two decades now. His work has led to the discovery of two new genera of reptiles and the discovery of 56 reptile species from the Western Ghats. His contribution to the study of reptiles has been acknowledged worldwide, naming four species and one genera of reptiles after him. He will speak to us today more on the species in focus. So over to you, sir. So you need to unmute yourself. Yeah.
Yeah, thank you very much for a brief introduction. Okay. I would like to, I think I'll start my presentation first and then. I hope the presentation is visible.
It's visible, sir.
Yeah. Okay. At the onset, I would like to extend my warmest gratitude towards Central Zoo Authority of India for providing me this opportunity, to talk about one of the species about which I have a very limited knowledge, and Dr. Gauri Mallapur asked me to give a talk, and it was very difficult for me to deny that, because talking about certain things about which you really don't know is a big burden. So I managed myself to read a bit and lot about it for the last few days, and I'm trying to put forth a few thoughts about what I learned in the last 2-3 days about this particular species. Okay, that's why, and at the onset, I would like to request all of you to bear with me if I miss on certain important things, or if I share some information which may not be the right information as such. Thank you very much for. Okay, let's look at the monitor lizards. So when it comes to reptiles, the enigmatic groups which carries much attention, think about snakes. The first thing which comes to our brain or our mind or the heart is king cobra, then crocodiles. And when we talk about lizards, I think the monitor lizards are the ones which really carry the attention. People talk about them, and we know quite a lot of things about them. And in true sense, they are the real monitors of the lizard world. They are like big in size. Look at their size, The smallest one is around 20 centimeter and the biggest one is around 10 feet. Imagine such a wider range of size they have. And I'm talking about the monitor lizards across the globe. Now let's start with that and then come to the species in focus. Okay, so if you look at any monitor lizard, they do have a very unique body feature. They are like quite elongated, quite slender. They have a very long neck. Look at their scales, they are granular, they look like granules. I hope many of you must be eating a fish rava fry. Look at the texture on that, and the scales here are exactly like that. And they do have very strong feet. Okay, and why do they have strong feet? Because they are the best runners. They go hunting on whatever they can overtake, and to do that, they have to have very strong feet. Strong muscular feet, okay, and they have a bifid tongue. Like snakes, their tongue is also bifurcated. Okay, so this is something unique about monitor lizards, and this is true for most of the monitor lizards across the globe. Look at the distribution, no? They are mostly found in Africa, and no, here you can see that Australia and Asia, Southeast Asia, in all these countries, monitor lizards are mostly old world, not in the new world. I think there are a few accidentally translocated in America, and they are there, but they are not native of those particular places. Okay, so this is about monitor lizards. And imagine, no, there are 80 different species of monitor lizards across the globe. No, means every monitor lizard looks same, but they are widely distributed. They are everywhere, and that makes them monitor again. Okay, because monitor is the, I think in our classroom also, monitor is the person who is the main person in the class. No, it's like that. So here in lizard world, they are really like a monitor because they are occupying varied habitats. No, you see them in different places. They are, no, they feed on different things, and that's how they are quite amazing. They are really big as well. So this is one of the extinct species called Magellania, and it was around, no, thought to be around 23 feet long. Imagine like a monitor lizard, such a big thing. No, and we know the extant species that Komodo dragon, they are really big. These are very unique lizards. When you talk about monitor lizards, I think I discussed a bit about them, but they are really unique in many ways. Okay. One of the important things to thought about them is every monitor lizard look alike, as I told you just before. No, they look the same. Why they are so distinct? What is the distinct features in them? So if you go close to their teeth and other body features, you will get minute changes. No, they are slightly here and there, and that particular slightly here and there is largely governed by what kind of food they eat and where do they live. They want to eat on a certain specialized food. They're some features are modified for that. No, but overall, all the monitor lizards generally look the same with slight modifications. They are everywhere. Interestingly, they are on the land, they can burrow underground, they are very good climbers, and they are very good swimmers as well. Means they are occupying in varied, they occupy varied habitats. So that's how they are really important again. No, interestingly, they are slightly venomous as well. There are studies which are conducted on their no saliva, which proved that, no, they do have some kind of saliva which is not problematic for humans, but it's not good for their food, what food they eat. Okay, so most of the monitor lizards are oviparous, and they dig pit and they put their eggs inside those pits, and that's how they breed. Okay, so they are unique lizards again, as I told you, as they dominated the varied habitats with little changes. So this is something really very important. So if you look at their evolution, it is believed that the monitor lizards evolved something around 65 million years ago in Asia, and then they diversified into Africa and other countries over a period of time. Let's talk about monitor lizards in India. Out of the 80 species known globally, I think there are four species which are known from India. Okay, and the commonest one is the Bengal monitor, water monitor, then yellow monitor, and desert monitor. So this is the poster, I think, designed by Ron Glass Sustin. So they talk very nicely. It's a very interactive poster, and here they discuss about certain body features which we can use for their identification. How these four different four species can be distinguished? Look at this poster. No, very interesting information is provided there, which you can use for their identification. It's very interesting. And look at few monitor lizards, their tail is flat. For example, I think I'll go there one by one. No, this is the common Indian monitor, one of the commonest monitor lizard in India, widely distributed, okay, like known from varied habitats everywhere. Okay, interestingly, the babies of this lizard look quite different than the adults, okay. And they are good swimmers as well. When I say they are good swimmers, look at their tail is slightly flattened. So that is one of the key features of their identification as well. And apart from that, if you look at the top of the tail goes like this. And if you look at the top here, there are two rows of scales. So these are some of the features we use them for their identification. Then, this is a desert a monitor, a specialized monitor lizard of arid landscapes. Very small in size, comparatively, it is smaller in size. And now, as I told you, they are arid landscape specialists, means they rarely go to the water. If they do that, then why do they need a flattened tail? Here, the tail is rounded. That is one of the key features to identify desert monitor lizard in India. Okay, so very interesting. See, when you look at their body features, try to ask a question, why do they have it? Look at the color, try to ask a question, why do they have it? And believe me, you're going to get some amazing answers in finding these things. So the desert monitor has a round tail. So this is yellow monitor. Okay. Not very common like other monitor lizard. This is uncommon monitor lizard and mostly seen in the floodplains of Ganges and Brahmaputra. Okay, so this is also quite interesting looking, rarely seen monitor lizard in India. And then the key species which we are going to talk today is the water monitor. The scientific name is Varanus salvator, and basically this is a truly aquatic dragon. So if you look at four different species now, the one species is widely distributed. It has dominated the land. Common monitor, Indian monitor lizard, or Bengal monitor. So that species has dominated the land. They are everywhere on the land. Now, going to the arid landscapes, life is very difficult. So there you need a different takes. So there you get a different species. Okay. Then being in a freshwater ecosystem, you have to have a different set of things. So yellow monitor was dominating that landscape. The another place where the thing was quite empty, that was the coastal areas. I'm talking about Indian perspective. And there you see this particular lizard. Means the water was not been dominated by lizards, and this lizard made an opportunity to go there and start feeding on getting the things there. So when we talk about a species called Varanus salvator, okay, so it has a wider distribution. Look at the distribution of this particular species. It starts from Sri Lanka, then northeastern coastal areas of India, then it goes to Southeast Asia, then it goes to quite a lot of countries there. So it truly has a very wide distribution. Now, by looking at that, we can ask some interesting questions. Now, the first question now, what is their favorite habitat? Now, when we say monitor lizard, means it is a lizard. It is a reptile. Now, it has to come out of the water. It can't be aquatic all the time because it has to breathe air from the atmosphere. They don't have any other mechanism to for the respiration like many aquatic animals. So here they have to come on the land. So if you look at their habitat features, they are mostly seen, close to water or nearer or in the swampy areas, mostly in the rivers or close to, mangrove forest and those kind of habitats. So this is their preferred place. Now what is happening here? Imagine you being a water monitor lizard and leave the aquatic habitat and go inside the land, little bit inside the land. In India, again, I'm talking, what will happen? You'll have a competitor there because common monitor is already there. So these lizards decided to utilize the space which is not been monitored by other monitors. Okay, so that's where they started utilizing the space, and they are mostly seen near the water or very close to the water or inside the water. That's why they are called water monitor lizards. Okay, then we discussed about the distribution. No, it's like really a wide distribution. Now that raises a very interesting question. Is it really a one species? Recently, one subspecies has been described from India. I hope you all know that. It's called Varanus sarvatra andamanensis. Okay, in the era of modern taxonomic revolutions, where we are using DNA as a tool to identify the species, I feel that considering them as subspecies is not a good idea. I think further studies are required, to answer these questions. Are they really subspecies, or are they really a distinct species? Why I'm asking this, or why I'm bringing this to the forefront? Because when I say that water monitor, then as species it becomes widely distributed. But we know that they do have certain things, and based on that, people have described subspecies. And if that is the case, then further studies are required, to delineate the subspecies, or considering the question that are they all same species or not. And with this, a big thing will come up, and that is their conservation. Today, if you look at the IUCN, I'm going to talk about that as well. IUCN say that water monitor lizard is least concerned. Yeah, naturally it should be least concerned because it has a wider distribution, and in many areas you get it. They are like commonly seen and blah blah blah. So by looking at that, they will be considered as least concerned. But in true sense, are they? That is the question. Okay, now look at the subspecies. They are distributed in a particular area as well. No, so this is a data which I derived from EML Reptile Database, and it gives us the insights that yes, there is a need of further studies to understand this. Okay. How big they grow? No? Because see, being a monitor lizard, there are many restrictions as well, because you need to, if you're a bigger body, your food requirement is more. So, and again, you have been bound by particular habitat restrictions and many other things. So can you become really big? No. But if you look at the monitor lizards, they manage to grow big. No, they are seen in the range from 1.5 to 2 meters. Probably they grow slightly bigger than that as well. And interestingly, the males are larger than the females, probably to do with the fighting and many other things as well. So this is about their size. And what do they have on their platter? What is their diet plan? Okay, so being a monitor lizard, living close to the aquatic habitats, if I become a specialized hunter, then life will be very difficult. Imagine you are a monitor lizard and you want to feed on a particular thing only. Will that be possible? No. So here, what they did, they started feeding on water they can overcome. I think if you look at their feeding style, they can eat anything whatever they can overcome. So that's what makes them unique again. No, it's like they have a varied feeding habitats as well. They like to feed on little things to larger things, from insects, invertebrates to mammals. Everything is there on their diet plan. And interestingly, to hunt a fish, they have to go underwater and remain there for a longer period of time. And these monitor lizards, over a period of time, probably they have gained the capacity to live underwater for as much, I think around, it says that they live underwater for 30 minutes or more. So I think that makes them really very good hunters. So see, when it comes to understanding the species, we need to understand many, many other things as well. And see, we always talk about certain things and we just stop the things. Or our thought process at that particular point as only. We say that, oh, this monitor lizard feeds on blah, blah, blah. The next question is, why do they do that? No, and that's where our level of understanding increases. And why I'm telling you this, I'll let you know over a period of time. Okay. How do they breed? As usual, no, it's like their sexual dimorphism is there. As I told you, males are bigger than the females. And one of the papers mentioned that when the male is around 1 meter long and the female is around 50 centimeter long, they are capable of breeding. They are ready to mate, ready for reproduction. So this is something really very interesting. So from that size, they start breeding. And then their breeding season is something, it starts from April to October, they say. And see, all this information, whatever we have, is quite anecdotal. No? Because when it comes to India, do we really know anything about it? Give a thought to this. I think we really don't know much about many of the species here in India. Okay, now, interestingly, this is one of the very interesting species of monitor lizard because it has seen in quite a lot of modified habitats as well. Now, you see them in agricultural fields. Yes, they are there. You can see them close to human habitations and very well. Okay. They are very comfortable in aquatic ecosystems, fresh water and marine as well. Like if you go to Sundarbans, this is one of the commonest lizard you can see there. So it's they are so adaptable to all these things. Okay. And again, I think we discussed about their diet preference. So they are very good at So this is all about the water monitor lizards in India. And all this information is quite anecdotal. Do you feel that we know anything about these enigmatic group of lizards? I don't feel so. We really don't know when they really breed. In what landscape, when do they breed, we don't know. Okay? We know that they are there in some coastal habitats and in strongly marine habitat as well. So how do they monitor their behavior there? Think about a water monitor in Sundarbans. How comfortable they live there? Andaman Nicobar Islands, there is one subspecies we are talking about now. So how comfortably they are living there? Give me one study where people have studied their ecology. We really don't know anything about that. We really don't know when do they breed, how much, what is their clutch size, what is their hatching time, and how the babies, what is the diet of babies, is the diet change as per the age, we don't know. So all these things are really, really very important. And I think in a country like India, which is filled with people, the biodiversity is taken for granted. And when it comes to species like this, they are highly neglected. Probably, I think this is the right platform for me to appeal all of you, to start asking these questions, to gain more information. And why we need this data? Because IUCN, as I told you, considered the water monitor as least concerned species. And if it is least concerned, then the problem is there is a lack of knowledge, and I'm talking about the populations from India again. Okay, so if you look at the threats associated with this particular species, they were hunted for skin. I think most of the monitor lizards, it is true for most of the monitor lizards. Okay, and they are also hunted for their meat and fat. Okay, I think it has been used for traditional medical practices and so on and so forth. Probably it is again true for all the monitor lizards. Okay, another threat says that habitat loss. I think habitat loss is a threat for everything, including the humans. Okay, and pollution. Yes, pollution is a problem because pollution will create issues for their availability of food and other resources. And yes, that could be one of the things. But don't you feel that all these things are quite anecdotal? We are just not understanding. Is pollution really a problem? We don't know. Is habitat loss is really a problem? We don't know. I think there are opportunities to understand all these aspects in true sense when it comes to water monitor lizards in India. And I feel that, if you really want to believe that the IUCN category, considering if IUCN is considering water monitor as least concern, we should be thinking about this twice. Because we really don't know, is it a species or a subspecies? And from there, the story starts. We really don't know what do they feed, when do they breed, how do they live, where do they live. Nothing is known. And without that, we are saying that this is least concern. I think we are taking this enigmatic species for granted. We have to change this perception. We have to go out and collect as much information as possible about this particular species. And this is where I am taking you all. So, this is a question I would like to ask everyone who is listening to this talk. And do we really know anything about water monitor lizards in India? Like, what do we know about them? I was trying to read about this for the last few days, and I realized that we really don't know anything. And this is true for most of the species in India. No? Think of any enigmatic species about which we have quite a lot of information, and that information which we can utilize for their conservation. There are very few species. I'm not going to talk about them, which are those. And we know a lot about, for example, tigers. We know everything about, we know like every tiger is named in India today. On the contrary, we don't know anything about monitor lizards, like water monitor. Nothing is known. No, it's like their population trend. Is their population is growing up or going up? We don't know. What is happening to them? We don't know. When do they breed? Is there any problem? We don't know. Nothing is known. And we should have the guts to accept this fact that we are neglecting much of the wildlife. We are taking our biodiversity for granted. Please say that. And the moment you say that, or the moment you realize it, you will start utilizing your resources and love to collect the information about this particular goose. So this is where I want to, take you. Again, I would like to extend my thanks to Central Zoo Authority of India for this short, wonderful opportunity to share my thoughts. Dr. Ashish Kumar, sir, thank you very much for this. Dr. Gauri Mallapur, I don't know why you chose me to give a talk on monitor lizards, but thank you very much because that opened quite a lot of avenues for my thought process as well. I really read a lot about it. Arundhati, thank you very much for being not a good communicator. I was not li replying to your emails and all those things. Thank you very much. And thank you all. Thank you.
No problem, sir. Thank you so much for giving an overview of this species and also urging everyone who's watching to, look more and study reptiles and especially, in terms of the monitor lizard. So we will take question answers for this session at the end. We now move on to the Know Your Zoo part of today's talk. So today to know, we have with us Mr. Ashish Kumar Samanta, who is the director of the Zoological Garden Alipur. Mr. Ashish is also an IFS and the Chief Conservator of Forest in Kolkata. He is a botanist by training and has over 3 decades of experience in the management of forests. He has served in various capacities as the Divisional Forest Officer with the West Bengal Forest Department before joining as the Director of the Zoo in 2015. He will today speak to us more on the rich history of the zoo and the current status. So over to you, sir. So you need to unmute yourself.
Yes, thank you,
Yes.
Arundhati ma'am, and good afternoon to all. I will start my presentation regarding my zoo. Just one second. Thank you. The history of Zoological Garden Alipur. The Zoological Garden Alipur is one of the oldest zoo in India. It was established in the year of 1875, covering an area of 18.81 hectare. Though history of establishment dates back as far as 1842. Initially, a sum of rupees 5,000 was sanctioned for immediate purpose of laying out and construction of the cheap and temporary structure. Subsequently, the contribution received from the people and the animal houses and enclosures are named after the principal donors. The first Indian donor was Raja Rajendra Mullik Bahadur, who donated money as well as animals. The first animal house in zoo constructed was Mullik House, named after him. There are the other animal houses and enclosures are Swarnamayi House, the Maharani Swarnamayi of Kasim Bazar, the Cylinder House, the member of the management committee, the Gabbi House, Baglan House, and other houses are constructed. Similarly, Ijera House, Bardhaman House, and other houses are also constructed by the donation from the Nawabs and Maharaja and general publics. The first Indian superintendent was Rai Bahadur Ammamma Sanal. Basically, he was a medical student of Calcutta Medical College, but due to problem in eyesight, he could not continue his studies. His two teachers, George King, the professor of botany in medical college, who later became the superintendent of Botanical Survey of India, and Dr. Anderson, professor of zoology medical college, who became the curator of Indian Museum at Calcutta, brought Ammamma Sanal to Alipur Zoo for supervision of various works. He started his career as a daily OGS, but he ultimately became superintendent through his knowledge, dedication, sincerity, and inquisitiveness. He used to note daily observation in a diary of a daily report, and later on he published a book titled A Handbook of the Management of Animals in Captivity in Lower Bengal in 1892. At that time, this was the first book in the world to manage the captive animals. He was a corresponding member of the Zoological Society of London. During his period, he was a pioneer in captive breeding in India. His scientific methods led to the live birth of a live Sumatran rhinoceros in 1889. It is the second recorded instance of rhinoceros breeding in captivity in the world. You know that Aditya, a 25 years old Ellaba tortoise gifted by Robert Clive's estate at Barakpur, and lived here for about a year up to 2006. Another remarkable thing is Tigon and Litigon, born here. The zoo produced its first hybrid big cat, a Tigon called Rudrani, on October 13, 1972. A female African lion Munni and a male tiger Munda. The second Tigon, Rongini, was born on March 8, 1974. Litigon, a hybrid cub, was born on March 7, 1979, after successful mating of a male Asiatic lion and a female Tigon Rudrani. The Litigon was named Cubanacana by Joseph Lopez Sanchez, by the erstwhile Cuban ambassador to India. Cubanacan, according to Guinness Book, in 1885 weighed 363 kg weight, stood 1.32 meters at the shoulder, and measured 3.5 meters in length. Now, management. The zoo was initially run by an honorary managing committee since 1875, but it is now under the West Bengal Zoo Authority since August 2009. We have a director, deputy director, assistant directors, and other keepers and office staffs. A little administrative structure here. Our mission of the Zoological Garden is conservation of wild animals from India and abroad, with special reference to the wetland fauna, and education research for sustainable conservation of wild fauna, which are under severe threat due to birding interference. This is the objectives of our zoo. This is the zoo map. This is a drone map, the green lung of the concrete body. There are some glimpses. The aviary from the top view. There are two aviary here. One is waterbed aviary. This is the rested area of the zoo. This is a part of the lake area. We have animal enclosures, their distribution like open land area, open water body area, road and footpath, public amenities, administration and amenities. Major stock of zoo animals: bird species 51, number 484, reptile species 18, number 127, and mammal species 33, number 148. We have a number of free living flora and fauna. There are 23 birds, 5 mammals, and other reptiles in our zoo. We have a 116 number of different tree species. Some are here. We have divided the area like exotic deer section, carnivore section, mammals and bird section, and several section to facilitate the visitors to enter to the zoo. This is a tiger area. Zoological Garden has a high annual footfall every year. That is, you see, in the year of 2017-18, it was 35.41 lakhs, 18-19, 32.72 lakhs, and 19-20, 29.32 lakhs. Highest recorded footfall was 120,000 in a single day in 2017. There is a several public amenities. We have a shed, souvenir shop. We have a child care center, toilet, drinking water facilities, and a restaurant. Security system: we have continuous vigilance through 100 plus CCTV cameras in different strategic locations. Presently, more than 230 persons, including Manushak, security staff, are engaged. During peak season, about 100 to 150 police personnel are deployed to maintain law and order situation. We have disaster management group equipped with the modern facilities. They work very good during the Amphan and Phoni. We provide medical assistance and conduct first aid camps during peak season in addition with the civil defense department. Animal diet: we have animal dietitian who usually maintains, supervise, and manage the diets along with the doctors, director, and labor directors. We take special care during summer, like physical method of cooling, like bathing, sprinkling, shade to enclosures, installation of fans, nutritional supplements, medicinal supplements, etc. Similarly, during winter, we also maintain physical methods like mammals for wooden planks to all carnivores. Reptiles provide adequate bedding for proper hibernation, nutritional supplements, mammals for calcium supplementation to all mammals, birds, etc., and medicinal supplements. Animal health care: the zoo runs a veterinary hospital for animal health care. We have 2 veterinary officers, 1 pathologist deployed by ERD department, 3 veterinary assistants, and we have a health advisory committee headed by joint director ERD department. The hospital equipped with the quarantine facility, OT room, daycare center, indoor ward facilities, and etc. See, the doctors are treating 1 python who are suffering from a tumor. We have wild dogs. These wild dogs are handled from the second day. This is operation of the Sundarban tiger in our OT. This is a ultrasonography of a jungle cat. We have an incubator and other laboratory facilities in veterinary hospital. E-governance: the eZoot Kolkata mobile application website has been launched as a communication for awareness generation, information sharing, ticketing system. We have also developed a cashless entry system due to COVID pandemic situation. We have also dedicated web-based system and mobile application. Zoological Garden Alipur is a member of GEMS Data Management Program of Species 360. Android mobile-based application for learning, guiding, and ticketing system. We have developed it here. Android mobile-based application for record keeping. We keep daily keeper's diary, daily report, and other reports in MIS system, and just we have started it. Zoo adoption: like other zoos, we have adoption program, but we have a separate adoption program. Like, we have adopted 1 month, one can take 1 month adoption, one can take 1 year adoption. During pandemic season, there are very few adopters, but in the year of 2021 to 22, we see about number is till date 54, and amount we have received is 10 lakhs. We place photos of the adapter to the anime enclosures and we display it in our Facebook website to encourage other people also. Exit conservation and research. Approved conservation breeding program as per our governing bodies, pheasants, Bengal winter lizards, python, three types python, rock python, retrograde python, Burmese python, banded crate, and mouse deer. We have research, we have taken number of research plans, captive breeding of fishing cats with detailed gynecological and andrological study of bacterial and fungal load in fish, buffalo meat, disease screening in captive giraffe with emphasis on captive training of a subadult giraffe, disease screening and breeding of captive large felids, and so on. Education and audit program, this plays a very important role for the people or awareness program. We have a zoo educator and she regularly they organize number of programs. It includes sit and draw, seminar, visit to zoo, etc. Due to COVID-19 pandemic, we are preferring to organize different online programs like webinar, quiz, and other traditional competitions like painting, etc. These are some of the glimpses of our outreach program, training program to staff, webinar in different subjects, capacity building program for veterinary assistant of the West Bengal Zoo Authority, we have 12 zoos in West Bengal. We have one day webinar on zoo veterinary case study. We have observed World Rhino Day through webinars and other awareness programs in the zoo. Glimpses of different engagement. You see there are different engagements for the animals. Captive breeding. Alipur Zoo is very much potential in captive breeding program. Species like giraffe. At present, we have 10 number of giraffes, perhaps the highest in the in our India or among the all zoos. We have 8 zebras, mouse deer, brown-tailed deer, pythons, anaconda. 19 number of anaconda. We have hatched painted stock, macaw, fishing cat, or state animal, wild dog, lion, etc. Breeding well in captivity. Some interesting experience and success story of our zoo, perhaps it will help the other zoo manager to get something from here. Earlier, 2 foals of Duti, one zebra, died in zoo due to non-episode of amniotic sac. After observation, it is learned that the amniotic sac is thicker than the normal one. So it did not rupture naturally and mother also indifferent to leak amniotic sac as usual. An initiative was taken for proper training of keeper on manual rupturing amniotic sac if not ruptured naturally. Our effort succeeded in 2016 when Duti, a female zebra, gave birth to one alive foal by manual rupturing of amniotic sac by your staff. Second, a giraffe cub was born in 2007 in zoo at about 4:30 p.m. and unfortunately it was unable to stand on feet even after 4 hours. Usually after born, the giraffe cub stand up within 2 hours and also devoid of sucking mother's milk. After discussion with the doctors and keepers, ORS and glucose are provided by cotton ball to avoid drainage of liquid to respiratory tract, frequently to prevent dehydration. Then we placed gunny bags beneath the belly and staff held both sides of the bag to support the calf and getting the strength back to its leg repeatedly. And also doctors massaged legs for 4 hours at regular intervals. After 5 hours of continuous effort, calf was able to stand and started to suck mother's milk. Second case, in 2020, another giraffe calf was born, but the mother refused to give milk to her calf, perhaps being the first mother. Initially, we provided ORS to calf to prevent dehydration in first day, and from the second day, we started to give ORS and milk of immediate lactating cow to get colostrum and continued up to 3rd days. We observed that the new mother feels tickling sensation in her udder when the calf is trying to suck milk, and that is the reason for uncomfortableness. We started to sponge the udder with a stick padding with lukewarm water soaked gauze to make animal feel comfortable for sucking and softening of udder. After 1.5 hours of continuous effort, we saw that the mother feels comfortable. Then he pushed the cup to suck milk and saw that the mother allow him give milk. Obviously, we have also experienced water mountain lizard. Previously, no water mountain lizard was born in captivity in a zoo. The detailed observation noted that the soil was hard enough to make burrow for egg laying. To make the soil porous, we placed a bundle of straw and soil layer after layer of sufficient thickness. The diet was changed also. Subsequently, we added chicken once in a week with a regular fish diet. In the next season, after rain, it was found that 10 numbers of new hatchlings came out in July, August. This process continues and they are giving birth till date. Next, fishing cat. There is also observation. Breeding of fishing cats, it is a state animal of West Bengal. In captivity was done after 4 years. A pair of fishing cat was taken to off display area, but continuous observation found that dominating male is having maximum food and female was getting weaker. Sub observation played vital role and we have modified feeding management. We started feeding separately and it works, and new offspring came in 2007. Thank you, madam. In brief, this is about my zoo.
Right. Thank you so much, sir, for the overview of the history of the zoo, as well as, you know, informing us on the current infrastructure abilities in place. So we now move on to the question answer session. So you can stop sharing the screen. It will be on the drop down menu when you take your cursor towards the top. So Dr. Bharat, we will take questions for the species section first. So the first question for you is that why is the species, the Varanus salvator, called the water monitor? Is there any special species adaptation to water?
So basically, it has to do with their habitat preference. No, it's like they are very, you know, comfortable, very close to the water. And I'm sure being close to water, they do have quite a lot of adaptations, which makes them quite unique. And that's why they are called as water monitor lizards. You know?
Okay.
And one of the interesting features which we can see in them is the kind of the tail they have. It's quite flat. And also their ability to go underwater. Their heart has a specialized feature which, you know, makes them very good underwater as well. And there are many other features which makes them quite unique.
All right, sir. And so the next question for you is that the distribution of the species is known to be like currently in Orissa, West Bengal, in those areas, but it is not reported from similar habitats in Tamil Nadu and other sites. So is there any, do you think there's any ecological or historical basis to this?
So if you look at the distribution of many reptiles and all those things, I think we were talking about their how the monitor lizards diversified into varied habitats. Probably, no, I'm not a very right person to answer this question, but I personally feel that the center of origin is somewhere else, and a small population which entered into India from that Middle Eastern connection, and that's why they come till Orissa, and after that we don't see them. No? Because if you look at India is not one country. It is composed of 10 different biogeographic zones. So any species which is coming from northeastern connections, it has distribution until Orissa, and very few species manage to go below that. So that could be one of the reasons.
Okay. All right, so and the next question for you is that monitor lizards have, you know, often been persecuted for the fear of venom. So, and now since from your talk, we know that a few of the species that do have venom. So in that, So in that aspect, how do you think areas where they are present in coexistence with people, you know, those awareness can be initiated, and you know, education can be done for them?
So to be frank, you know, if you look at the problems created by monitor lizards to humans, and think about the problems created by humans to monitor lizards, so tell me who is more venomous? More dangerous, I think. See, our perception is always wrong when it comes to reptiles. And that could be one of the reasons why, like, see, they are venomous, but that venom is not there to kill the humans because we are not on their diet list. Okay, we're not on their diet plan basically. So they don't attack us as well. Very rarely, whenever they are cornered, they attack us. Otherwise, tell me how many times the monitor lizard is coming and biting you. It's very, very rare. Spotting that is a tough challenge. And having somebody getting bitten by monitor lizard is probably a very rare chance. And the people who are trying to catch them, probably they'll get bitten by monitor lizards. Except that, I don't feel so. But think of monitor lizards. No, in Rajasthan, they are called a Chandan Go. And people say that they are very dangerous, venomous. No, so all lizards carry that venomous tag. And I think awareness is much more needed to let people make aware that they are not dangerous. Their venom doesn't kill us. Like, think of the biggest monitor lizard in the world, that is Komodo dragon. They do have certain things in their thing, but that is that kills the prey with a secondary infection, kind of bacterial infection and all those things. So they are not so dangerous as such. They're not venomous, but awareness is really needed. And whenever we talk about monitor lizards, we need to tell people that they are not dangerous, they're not venomous.
Right, so it lined with that question. Also, with that question, the next question for you is that: do you think the zoos can be a good learning ground about species whose biology is yet to be fully understood, and how do you think that they can progress with such a project?
So I think I was looking at Sir's presentation, and believe me, zoos does has tremendous potential because if you look at the amount of people who visit the zoo, and if you can start incorporating this information about lesser known life forms as well. So what happens whenever you go to a zoo, like the information, like, please don't correct me if I'm wrong, the information whatever is available on the Google. I don't have to visit the zoo for that. So zoo has more role. We have to cross that stereotypic thinking and planning and discussing things. We should go out of it. And suppose there is a particular zoo looking at a particular thing, building up a particular thing. So why not to enhance that? Why not to tell people that? When we talk about, suppose there is a cage of a monitor lizard, don't give the information like they lay eggs and they are this and that. Say something beyond that now. Let people go with the thought process. Tell that we really don't know anything about them. So their knowledge is very less. And whatever we know, we need to put that in a perspective so that people can go with some message. I think zoo does has a tremendous potential to create much needed awareness about biodiversity in India.
All right, sir. So I think those were the questions for you. And with that, now we move on to questions for the zoo. So Mr. Aziz, are you there with us?
Please.
Yes. Okay, sir. So the first question for you is that that the Alipur Zoo is one of the oldest zoos in the country. So how does the zoo propose to retain its history and tradition in terms of any development plans that you may have?
Within the short area, we have a specific development plan for the animals. You see that previously animals are kept in a small cages, but we have, as per CJD guideline, we have increased the area. For the tigers, there are three tiger enclosures, more than 2,000 square meter of each tiger, where tigers can roam. And there are water body river area and other enclosures, which are more or less as per direction of the CJD.
Okay, sir. And so the next question for you is that, are there any plans to engage with conservation of species that are adapted to mangrove ecosystems, like other than the water monitor, like there is the northern river terrapin, anything like that? Do you have any plans?
We have a conservation proposal already. I have discussed a fishing cat. That is a state animal. It is taking for progression. Next, water monitor lizard also in your pipeline. And 3 to 4 species per conservation breeding program, and subsequently released in the nature.
Okay, All right, sir. And I think those are the questions for you. Rest are a few comments that are there. So I think with that, these are the questions for, we've come to an end to the 42nd Know Your Species, Know Your Zoo Talk. So on behalf of the Central Zoo Authority, I would like to thank both Dr. Bharat Giri and to you, Mr. Aziz, for taking time out of his schedule and joining us for this talk. And I would also like to thank the audience who have been with us throughout. And I would also like to inform them that we will be back, Nick, that before that, we have that Kolkata Zoo will be continuing the outreach activities throughout this week. So do tune in to the social media pages to know more on what talks and activities they have planned. And we will be back again next week with our week 43rd species, which is on vipers, and on the zoo, which is the Chennai Snake Park. So do tune in for that talk from 4 to 5 p.m. next week. So see you then, and thank you again very much. Namaskar.
Thank you, ma'am. I express my sincere thanks to Mr. S.P. Jadhav, Member Secretary, Sir, CJD, and also you and other senior officers for selecting Zoological Garden Alipur for Azadi Ki Amrit Mahotsav Week 42. I also express my sincere thanks to Swangli Ghosh, ma'am. We have organized two webinars and other awareness programs like quiz, photography competition, story writing, etc. from 27th December to 2nd January under the guidance of our Central Zoo Authority. We hope we will be able to disseminate the messages and awareness for protecting and conserving the water mountain lizard to the mass at a grassroots level. Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you so much, sir.